scripture passage is Matthew 25, 32 through 46. And Jesus is talking and showing who he is. It says, "All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will put the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. And then the king will say to those on his right, 'Come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me.' Then the righteous will answer him, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothing? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you?' The king will reply, 'Truly I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me.' Then he will say to those on his left, 'Depart from me, you who are cursed, into the eternal fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me nothing to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not invite me in. I needed clothes, and you did not clothe me. I was sick and in prison, and you did not look after me.' They will also answer, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or needing clothes or sick or in prison and did not help you?' He will reply, 'Truly I tell you, whatever you did not do for one of the least of these, you did not do for me.' Then they will go away to eternal punishment, but the righteous to eternal life." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. Let's take a moment and pray. Lord, as we approach your word today, we pray that we would receive your spirit, that we would be able to look at Christ as King. And Lord, as we do that today, we ask that you prepare our hearts for such an experience. Help us to meet Christ today. We pray this in your name. Amen. So it is Christ the King Sunday today, which always gives me a little bit of a reaction, because I know that it is always the first Sunday or the last Sunday before Advent. And Advent, as you know, can be a very busy season in the life of the church. And here we are already, it's coming at us. Well, the idea of King is not a new idea. It is something that we may have grown up reading about in children's books or in our fairy tales, or maybe we saw it in Disney movies. You know, I have preached about kings or kingdoms before, but I want to go back with you and I want to look at what it means to be a biblical king, what it means for Jesus to be king. We are a little bit unfamiliar with what it means to be a king. For you see, we have a president and a vice president and a cabinet in our society, our country. In our schools, we have principals, but we don't call him or her king or queen. Our boss may want to be king of our workplace, but we don't let him or her be called king or queen. The man of the house may want to be called king, and maybe some are called that, but usually husband or partner is best. The word king in our society is thought to be somewhat arrogant. If I would say, I am king of the church today, I'm sure you'd be talking about me at your dinner today. We have our kings in our society, but they are the burger kind, or the king of pop, Michael Jackson, or Elvis, we still call him king. But real kings, we really don't have. Sure, we read about them, and we have them in our cartoons, in our neighborhoods of make-believe, but we don't have kings, per se, in our culture. Matthew 25, verse 31 states, When the Son of Man comes in glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. Jesus is going to come again someday, and he's going to be king. There will be final days of judgment, the end. And when he comes back, he's going to be king. And what that means is that Jesus will have ultimate authority. He's going to be given ultimate control. The ultimate control will be given to Christ so that God can judge. Now this is very hard for us to trust in that. To trust in a leader like that. You know, because our leaders are so hard for us to understand anymore. At least they are for me. They're becoming very hard to trust and understand. And I don't know why, per se, but I could guess that maybe it stems that these people are so removed to who we are, that maybe they have it so much differently than we do, that they can't possibly understand who we are and how we can trust them. How can we trust people who don't know us? But as Christ is King, we must know that he understands us. He has been where we have been. And you know what? In fact, he's had it much worse than we have. And the love of God shows us much grace. So Jesus, in God in human flesh, his authority must be something we could welcome into our life, as there would be much grace and understanding. And this would be giving authority to someone who knows us, someone who has been here, someone who has been there. Many of our societies, our leaders in our society today, have no idea what it means to be us. Obama, Trump, probably most of our congressmen have no idea. But Jesus, he does. He knows what it means to be tempted, persecuted, humbled. Christ knows that life is hard. So we have a king, a leader that knows our situation. What it means to be human, what it means to be lost, alone, and broken. And let's look at what he says in Matthew 25. Jesus says that there's going to be a judgment. He will separate the sheep from the goats. Now, sheep were more valued than goats at the time of Jesus. So those that are more valued, those that follow, will be put on at the right side, which if you look at ancient texts and you know anything about some of that, the traditions, we would see that the preferred side is the right side. These sheep on the right are the favored and will inherit the kingdom of God. And to us who are reading, so it matters then on how we live our lives. Jesus says that when we do the standard things that he is commanding, somebody's like giving somebody something to drink, someone welcoming, giving clothes, when we do those standard things, it will be like we do it unto him. Then Jesus says, we will not be real clear on our understanding. And we'll say things like, when we haven't done those things, like, Lord, when did we see you hungry and naked? And Jesus is then moving the argument forward. Jesus is saying, if we do not receive the least of these, we do not receive him either. Now, some scholars believe that this is missionaries at that time, those that were doing the work of God, who may be in dire straits. Those who do not take care of their brother or sister who are in need are the goats. Now Jesus says something pretty harsh in verse 41 then. Look at this. And he will say to those at his left hand, those who are not favored, those who do not follow, you that are cursed, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. Jesus tells us that it matters on how we live. Yet, we know that we are not judged on our work, but our faith. And could it be that these works are a reflection of how deep our faith really is? Now, if you look at this passage, does Jesus say that we need to be looking out for our own need? That we should be making sure that we have enough for self? That we should be moving on up to get our piece of the pie? Maybe, just maybe, deep faith, the kind of faith that follows Jesus, is all about the other. That's when we will truly, that when we truly live for the other, we will discover our true faith. We will discover our faith. That when it is about us, that we are very distracted and cannot see God. Yes, I have needs, you have needs. And I know that I have been taught that I need to take care of myself. And there's nothing wrong with having the things that we need. But if we are truly for the other, our needs would become less important. Now I get that we need to be taking care of ourselves and our own physical needs first. You know, as a person who serves, I am not good for anyone if I don't take care of myself. But Jesus is talking beyond that. He's talking about community. For those who were looking out for one another, if they were really looking out for one another, if we were really looking out for one another, there would be others looking out for you, too. For we would be the others for someone else. Jesus says that if we do not do things for the other, it is like we cannot do anything for him. Which makes sense. If we are so distracted by ourselves, with ourselves, then how can we see Christ? How can can I see Jesus in you? How can you see Jesus in me if we are all about ourselves? We need to be about the other. But this is so countercultural, is it not? In a world that teaches us to climb the ladder of success, a world that teaches us to broadcast where we are every minute through social media, a world that is teaching us that we must have our lattes and our cappuccinos or our iced teas. How are we truly looking out for the other? How are we welcoming people into our lives? You know what? Maybe this is why Christ the King Sunday falls right before Advent. How can we experience the peace, the love, the joy that Jesus brings if we are so caught up with who we are as ourselves? What if instead of updating our status on Facebook, we call somebody and find out how their day was? What if instead of seeking the new eating place, we worked at the soup kitchen or worked at the food pantry? What if we were about the other? You know, why does it take tragedy for us to really look at others? For it does do that. It does take that a lot of times. Hold on to your hats, folks. We are zooming now to Christmas. Let's welcome Jesus as King into our lives, knowing that the King that we serve is all about us, and we should be all about Him, and all about the others that are in our lives. For if we give ourselves away this year, maybe we would truly find Christmas. We would truly find Christ. Let's pray. Lord God, as we think about Jesus as King, we know He came to show us one of the important lessons of His life should be for us, that it is all about the others. That it is not necessarily just about me, but it is about the others in our lives. You know, Lord, there are so many others in our life. There is oneself. And Lord, we are other to so many other people. And Lord, as we think about that, it's kind of overwhelming. And Lord, we just thank you for your example on being for the other as King, a King like no other King.